are pretty solid on germ theory at this point. The idea that many diseases are caused and spread by pathogens too small to see has been locked in since the mid-19th century. But that wasn't the first time people came up with those ideas. Physicians around the world had been theorizing about the spread of infectious disease through invisible particles as early as the 9th century. That is 1,000 years earlier. These scholars did everything they could to limit the spread of infection and understand how it worked. But if we had the basis for germ theory, by all accounts a correct idea, why did it take so long for it to actually take root? Well, because right ideas don't always win, not right away. And sometimes wrong ideas can be pretty convincing. So let's take a look at why one of the most important ideas in biology took centuries to accept. Before germ theory, the main idea behind the spread of diseases was called miasma theory. Miasma theory says that you catch diseases from bad air, so anything that smelled bad or rotten was the reason you'd get sick. In some ways, it makes sense why people believed this. Places that are crowded and smelly do also tend to be hotbeds of disease. Although we now know it's because of the viruses and bacteria that come with waste and crowded areas, not the air itself. It just so happened that many of the prevention methods against miasma also prevented the transmission of disease from germs. For example, people got rid of bad air by swiftly removing waste and dead bodies from populated areas, which is still an important way to prevent disease transmission in the modern era. But around the time of the Black Death in the 1300s, it became clear that miasma theory was not enough to explain the spread of disease. Some people looked for explanations to augment miasma theory, including that the celestial energies of Mars and Jupiter were drawing up toxic air from the Earth, and you thought Mercury being in retrograde was bad. But some people had another idea. They started thinking that diseases might actually come from something other than the air, a contagion. Some European cities started implementing quarantines on incoming ships to make sure that sailors weren't bringing in any diseases with them. That's not to say that everyone was suddenly team contagion now, but as the Black Death continued to devastate Eurasia, people began to put more contagion-based ideas together with miasma. Some doctors thought that while the body could make more of a disease and spread it to others, miasmas were what caused the initial illness. In fact, the classic plague doctor mask was born from miasma theories during the Black Death. The iconic beak shape was created to store sweet-smelling things for the doctors to breathe instead of the stinky, sick air, and it included spices like cinnamon and myrrh. Oh, and ground up vipers, just for funsies. This wasn't even the first time in history that people were combining miasma and contagion theories. In the 9th century, a scholar named Custa ibn Luca hypothesized that some diseases were spread by foul air and others by a spark of illness that can jump from a sick person to a healthy one. In 1546, an Italian physician named Girolamo Fracastoro published the first known work proposing a fully contagion-based theory of disease. Despite having no knowledge of microbes, he theorized that diseases were spread by so-called seeds that caused illness when they came into contact with people. Fracastoro started his disease studies by looking at syphilis and animal outbreaks. He noticed that syphilis seemed to pass primarily from person to person through sexual contact, and sick animals would get the entire herd sick if they weren't isolated. After reading a poem that described invisible seeds floating through the air, some fostering life and others creating disease, Fracastoro found his analogy for contagion. Never let anyone tell you that scientists don't need to study the arts. Fracastoro hypothesized that seeds of disease were all around us, and they could multiply inside a host before spreading to other people. They could spread through direct contact, like syphilis, they could float through the air, or they could be passed from person to person through a contaminated object. He coined the term fomites for these surfaces that can pass on disease from one person to another, and we still use that term term today. Even though Fracastoro got many things shockingly spot on, his ideas were mostly passed over for 300 years. In good scientific fashion, he presented his thoughts on seeds and contagion to his peers, who debated and ultimately rejected it. And it's not that his colleagues were being unscientific by rejecting his ideas. At this point, Fracastoro was simply hypothesizing, and he didn't do any experiments to back up his claims. It's funny how things that we may take for granted now seemed like wild, half-baked ideas back in the day. I mean, really, imagine our world full of tiny little dudes completely self-sufficient and self-replicating and living complex lives, then wiping out the human population on the side. Oh, and they're invisible, by the way. Come on, like, why would you think that when stinky air is literally right there under your nose? Science needed the proof of actually seeing a whole hidden world of microorganisms in order to accept Fracastoro's ideas for what they were. It's not really Fracastoro's fault. He couldn't do the experiments that his theory so badly needed. It wouldn't be until decades later that the first microscope was invented, then another 100-ish years for Antony von Leeuwenhoek to observe bacteria for the first time. Even as more and more people started to buy into contagion theories, it would still take more convincing for scientists to fully hop on the contagion bandwagon. Around the 18th century, people started to split into two camps of disease theory, and like all good rivalries, they got team names. You have contagionists, who are backing the idea that disease is caused by microorganisms, and you have miasmatists, who are backing the idea of, well, miasma. Since miasma was already the dominant worldview, contagionists had the burden of proof. A lot of early contagionist ideas were able to be explained away by miasma and coincidences, like patients surviving the ineffective miasma-based treatments fed into the pre-existing beliefs. Contagionists needed clear proof to sway the scientific community, and throughout all this time, they still didn't have anything to point to as a clear cause and effect from a germ to a disease. The proof took all the way until the late 1800s, when Robert Koch isolated anthrax bacteria from cows to infect mice, who then got anthrax and died. This experiment confirmed what Fracastoro and so many others had suspected all along. Germs cause disease, not bad air. From there, germ theory really took flight, and a thorough series of experiments during the early 1900s finally settled the debate. Even if Fracastoro was just spitballing at the time, he was vindicated eventually. Science is a process, and sometimes that process takes a while, but it's a process that helps ideas rise to the top when they're supported by evidence. And thanks to germ theory, we have vaccines and huge advances in public health. Finally, this video was inspired by Airborne, a new book by Carl Zimmer. It's a history of airborne disease and how it has shaped the world. If you'd like to check it out, head to the SciShow bookshop page. This video was made possible by the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation.